You've also heard that you have been delivered, once you have initiated in Christ. Should you present your body as a living sacrifice, as a man of Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, amongst the all sacrifice, it's a living sacrifice in your reasonable service. Have you done it? You know Romans chapter 6, which talks about on a daily basis presenting your members and instruments to God, members and instruments of the righteousness. Here, Lord, I give myself away. I hope you can get an engine so that I can have these. We say, I give up to the these other areas of the world. Words that are meaning when they come out of your mouth, I'll let you account for them. Matthew chapter 13. Every bad word, then it shall speak. They shall give account thereof. In the day of judgment. Think about it, I'm going to turn to the will of Exodus chapter 6, the passage we read just a few moments ago. We're looking at a covenant and a land, part number 2 today. We have two different covenants mentioned by God here in this passage that is before us today, in the particular verses 4 through 6. We find the covenant of the land.
We saw the mosaic representation specifically with the national Israel. Our love, in fact, sometimes seems to be
church is not obligated, or should not be obligated by the law. The church is obligated to please God by their love for Christ. Love of Christ keeps you from sin. Love of Christ is humble and not proud. Love of Christ points to extreme legalism and lasciviousness. Love of Christ is joy and honor and firmness of the Spirit. The law can never be made of that. Let me go on to the city government, which is where our focus is today. The government of the land. And I think it's very appropriate in light of the fact we've all been watching what's going on with the mosques and the past week. So I think you have a ceasefire going on for 2 hours before mosques attack again. But God has promised the land to Israel. We're going to see a lot of passages related to that this week before we're living. We talk briefly about the divinity covenant by our hearts. They get just as monster, they get the number of people, they get this room, they get that as a curve, they get seeking the center of the room, competing forever. God is sort of right, Jesus gave his son to the center of the covenant of non-glory, and the God is never leading his son initial and his ultimate fulfillment, which takes place, of course, in Christ, which draws on the millennial covenant and the new covenant, the last two covenants as we spoke of here, not that every system. The sixth covenant of the nine, the covenant of the land. And before we begin, this is Palestinian covenant, and probably bad meaning because it's my language, so it's all Palestinian. Remember, Jesus is a Israel today. But the covenant of the land, we need to understand God's covenants of the national Israel are prophetic. That's very important. God's covenants of Israel are prophetic. And therefore, they contain several basic features and underlying premises that undergird all of Old Testament and New Testament prophecy. First, a natural normal reading of Scripture has a striking feature that every time God fulfills prophecy, and I see hundreds of prophecies that are already fulfilled. You can go all the way through the Old Testament, and you see hundreds of prophecies that have been fulfilled. There are over 300 prophecies that relate to Jesus Christ alone. All that have been fulfilled, they're fulfilled in time past. Every one is fulfilled literally, normally, naturally, you can have twisted it. It was exactly the way God said at the beginning. When God said he was born of Bethlehem, for example, he was born of Bethlehem. He wasn't just born in the land of Israel. He wasn't born in some place in Siberia because later than in Bethlehem, they make prophecies dead. When God said he was born of a virgin, he was just born of a virgin. People argue about all in the Old Testament, meaning a young woman. But the Greek term in the New Testament is chronos, meaning an individual, technical, absolute virgin. When God fulfills prophecies, he fulfills them literally, precisely, exactly every prophecy that has been fulfilled thus far. Everyone, no exceptions, everyone has been fulfilled literally. Normal hermeneutic, that is the interpretation of the text, you take the words of what they mean. God uses symbols, he always explains the symbols. He always explains the symbols, so much else, but obviously you don't have to guess about it. We'll look at that in just a second. No prophecy of the past has ever been fulfilled non-literally. No prophecy of the past has ever been spiritualized away from their normal natural meaning. Prophecies are traditional, it is prophetic. This is Jesus believed all future prophecies will be given with the only one that's involved in language. It is used to describe the past. Maybe they can use it to say, well, how does that work? It's involved in language. It's always explained in the form of scripture. You don't have to think of the interpretation of the illustration of this. But it tells us twice in the passage that talks about this. It tells us twice what the system means. Revelation chapter 12, verse 3. There are another moment in heaven, and behold, the great red dragon. I also picture the picture of the dragon, I suppose. And I suppose as you picture your mind right now, I know it's red, and I know it's big. Behold, the great dragon, having seven heads and seven horns, and seven crowns on his heads. And his tail, who the first part of the stars of heaven, and cast into the earth, and the dragon said to a woman, which was a trigger to be delivered for the devourer of child, so that it is warm. And there was a word in heaven, and the angels were fighting against the dragon, Is it very rewarding to ask a question? Is it very rewarding to ask to come out of court? Is it very rewarding to miss law?
No.
We are told what it is. Which is seen, all that is seen, which is seen the whole world. He was cast out of here, and then he was cast out. And when the bride is always cast out of here, he persecuted the woman and drove off the man's child. And there you go, the woman that opened her mouth and saw them. The dragon was called the woman with his father, and they put it on him again at chapter 20, verse 2. And in the old woman, the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and now for 1,000 years. Now, folks, it's going to us. Prophecy sometimes uses a small language, but the prophecy is literal. There's a literal devil, there's a literal Satan. There's a literal angelic being in their rebellion against God, who has an angelic host of calling him, who are referred to as demons. And then there are not enemies. In that passage, and you know what kind of little all symbols there, in that passage, he stands up against Israel, woman, and the child, who is the Messiah. Because there's something in that passage which is kind of cool in all symbols. And where there is time. But if you want, notice something else that says, God in 1,000 years, it says 1,000 years. In fact, it says 6 times in Revelation chapter 20. It does not say a long heaven period of time. It does not say that the long heaven period of time is right now. And that says it's not a long chain over the earth, which is what you'll find if you go to this unlimited, which is what they always say, the boundary is on a long chain. Because the moment is going on right now, that 1,000 years is really 1,000 years, it's all this period of time that we're living in, you know, so we're in heaven. It seems to me that God says it's 1,000 years, and he says it 6 different times. Nobody knew it was 1,000 years. And that's saying that now, we can't walk around over 3,000 years, because this is the way of pregnancy, releasing the end of 1,000 years, and it went up back to earth. Folks, be careful when you are interpreting Scripture, which may have not really said anything verses, chapter 3, verses 3 through 13, because that's the passage that you should go to where they say, well, one day with the Lord is 1,000 years, 1,000 years a day. You realize that it denies that passage. We're going to use some very specific things. In fact, if you can make that in that period of time, you have just talked about some meaning God into Scripture. In that exact context, Peter deals with the issue of creation. He deals with the issue of the age of earth. He deals with the literal flood of Noah. He deals with the literalness of the coming judgment. Be careful the way you answer for sure. If you not have 1,000 years in Revelation chapter 20, you're not going to have 1,000 years in 2 Peter 2, because it's also dealing in 2 Peter with end time events, but it's also time of creation. It's also time of the flood of Noah. It's also time of coming kind of judgment. Be very careful when you have Scripture. And so Peter ends that passage and says, looking for the season of the coming of the day of God, for in the heaven of the thing on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall not look for her heat. Nevertheless, we according to his promises through the heavens and earth, where any moment of righteousness, wherefore we love the sea, and she looks for such thing, and be diligent, that she may be found in an peace, without spot, and blameless. Understanding prophecy correctly, and we'll talk about this in just a moment. Understanding prophecy correctly is a location for holy living. If it's all sort of outward, if it's all sort of, you know, living stuff out there, and it doesn't really matter, there is no motivation for living a godly life. Every man that has this holy kingdom, that is in context of the first John, every man that has this holy kingdom, purifying himself as he is pure. Why not? All prophecies of the past have been fulfilled with the fulfillment of literally. 22. All prophecies of the future will be fulfilled literally based on what we see Scripture declaring and prophetic. 23. Prophecies concerning national Israel is prophetic and fits the If we are served with salvation, we have been in the lead. 2 Timothy 3:16, all service is given by my declaration of God. I'm both in it. Everything except prophecy is given by my declaration of God. All service is given by my declaration of God. And it is profitable. In other words, it's not just inspired, but it has practical use. It is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for progression, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. It has an effect on the Christian life. Inspiration, and all prophetic inspiration, has an effect on the Christian life, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. Proverbs 3:5. Every word of God is pure, including prophecy. It is a shield unto them that put their trust in Him. Sometimes I don't like what prophecy has to say because it's scary. Just remember that God who gave those pure words is a shield unto those who put their trust in Him. Luke 4. In other words, every prophecy which is inspired is given so that man will live a certain way. Man shall not live by every word, but by every word of God. How about the prophecy? How does it affect the way in which you live in this world? Folks, this is just a thing that we're going to do. The short stage is really for the Lord's return. Does the inner return of Christ motivation to live a holy life? Does it motivate you to witness? Does it motivate you not to waste time? Does it motivate you to use every moment that you have with Jesus Christ? You don't know how long you will live. You don't know where Christ will come back in the middle of this service. Does it motivate you? All Jesus says, I surrender. Do you? I surrender all. Friend, we're talking very serious business when we talk about prophecy. Believing in prophetic truth results in holy living. We love the Lord, your sons of God, and another not like every holy shall be. But when we look at what He shall appear, we shall be like it, for we shall see Him as it is.
Where I see the earth, for the Lord of hosts is
criticisms of other religions than the Old Testament.
He said,
but what was the answer that I began? Folks, even though we don't see, even though we know what's happening, God is in this experiment. This is what God says. I have reserved for myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. Even so then, now listen to these next words. At this present time also there is a remnant, a remnant of whom? A remnant of Jews. A remnant according to the action of grace. No, God has not cast away his people. The second discovery is the covenant of the city of heaven, the covenant of the land. Here it is a land where the old covenant was fully initial, although Jesus would cast out periods of time and divided the blood of their lives. But we find that covenant that I referred to earlier in Genesis chapter 15, verses 17 and 18. And he came to pass, and when the sun went down, it was dark, behold, the smoking furnace. And a burning land would pass between those pieces of the slaughtered animals. In the same day, where his verse says this, in the same day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, unto thy seed have I given this land, from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates. Now, folks, Israel has never yet possessed that sand of land. You look at the map and look at everything that goes from the Nile River over to the Euphrates River. Even in the days of Solomon and David, the land did not extend that far. But God calls it an everlasting covenant that he made with Abram, who is later given the name Abraham, that land belongs to them. Joshua chapter 1. Now, after that, Moses, the servant of the Lord, came to pass, the Lord speaking to Joshua, the son of Moses, the minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, O Lord, this servant, thou and all his people, unto the land which I give to them, even to the children of Israel. Listen to verse 3. Every place in the soul of your throat shall turn upon that I have given unto you, as I said unto Moses. This is not the world. Every place out of the world, because the logic of it is sufficiently in the church. Well, perhaps you didn't say that yet. Does your feet tread upon? Do I identify you with the children of Israel? From the wilderness of the land and the river, do you create all that I did? And out of the sea of your own land, the sun shall be your dress. There shall not be any man who will stand before you all the days of my life, as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you, nor forsake thee. Be strong and be courage, for unto this people shall not abide for an inheritance. The land which I swear to the fathers to give to them. Now, we should know that we're looking at this, and we're running out of time to finish today. You know, folks, this is a life we actually have to just follow the time here. So this past week, I spent 3 days attending a church meeting on this, a church planner, a church meeting, a church building. Later, I had a session with my mom, and I had a break. He went back to these services. Services start at 6:30. Services last sometimes until 10:30, almost to 11. Sometimes they have two pictures. One hour and a half together. Two times like 5 and a half, or sometimes it's 10:30, and then the other. I reach for 3 or 5 minutes, and I speak to you. Nobody with me. I won't bring you about 4 hours today. But I want you to know a couple of things. Looking at the promises here, the Bible prophesies that Israel will be cast out as a nation from the land 3 times. And it prophesies on 3 different occasions that they will be restored. Do you know where we are? We have a kind of problem that they use. Israel has already been cast out 3 times. Babylon, Syria, Rome. 2 of those 9 have been you understand where you are, but this is a little prophetic. I am not. Let me give you a couple of lines of the next time. Here's Jeremiah 25:11. Jeremiah prophesied me, says in the Bible, in the activity. This is all energy of the desolation and the sons of the nation shall serve the king of Babylon 7 years. It wasn't 71, it wasn't 69. God wonders in him because God had a precise timetable in God's wonders in him in Asia. And as he took up the past, he said, here's your knowledge, what I want to be with the Babylon, that nation of the Lord, for their iniquity, and the land of God, and the land of your country of desolation. And I will recall that in all my words, which I have not seen, is keep all the scriptures of the Lord, Jeremiah prophesied against all nations. We find that God gives us principle. Well, this is a very nice chapter in our chapter 28, which we're trying to read that. We find God promises to restore the land of their land. In fact, we find Daniel was reading the book of Jeremiah, and it suddenly realized that they were here at the end of the 7 years of the history of God in Jeremiah chapter 25. Daniel chapter 9, verse 2. In the first year of this